Okay, we're live. I'll see if I can hang on for a few minutes here. I'm not feeling very well for everyone watching, so if I duck out and let these guys talk without me, it'd probably be a better show anyway. So
No.
anyway, welcome to the show. This is our regular Sunday show. Next, I believe, I'll double check, but I believe it's next Sunday. We're going to have Stephen Mark Rainey on the show. And he's always a hell of a lot of fun to talk to. So I don't really have an agenda. It should be a lot less.
I got something to say. I got something to say. I got you
Yeah.
figured out, Pete. I know the title of the weird
Yeah.
company, I think, should probably be, it should be Rosencrantz and Guildenstern Are Dead, Lovecraft style. Because it's like, this is what is going on when you're not reading the Lovecraft story.
Well,
The
yeah.
story has to go
Wait.
on.
Can I be my normal troublemaking self and say, ladies and gentlemen out there in viewer lands, this is why Matthew Carpenter doesn't write books.
Ow.
If that's the title, can you imagine what would be between the covers? Good Lord,
Oh,
help us
Oh,
all.
no,
I think that would
seriously.
sell a lot of books.
It's the idea of it, though, not the
I
title. The Weird
know.
Company's a better title. That's what's going on.
Well,
That's
put
the
that in
thing.
the introduction. Don't make that the good. Oh, Lord.
Or I've got another alternate title for the Weird Company.
I got my slides away. If Joe, you know, my pen name is Danielle Steele, and I've sold a lot more books than you think.
Well, I one thing that Pete did in that book was it has no connection to Alien, but it was sort of Prometheus done right. If you read the book, you're going to know what I'm talking about. It's a setup for something else that I didn't expect.
I haven't finished it. I'm really enjoying it.
I
Pat, are you
finished
having a
it
headache or
last night.
something?
I finished it
What's
last
that?
night. It's wonderful.
Are you talking to me? Oh my God, I'm out of it. Jesus.
Well, so we, Nanny and I ran through about, I don't know, 30 or 40 titles coming up on this, and we recycled them. And, you know, the working title was League of Lovecraftian Gentlemen. And at one point it was the Miskatonic Men's Club, but men was crossed out and in lipstick was written women's. So we were playing with the Miskatonic Club, the Miskatonic Men's Club, the Miskatonic Oddfellows Society.
Oh, I like that one.
The Miskatonic AIDS Society. It could have,
Yeah.
a lot of things could have happened, but I wrote that one section where they used the term, and it just stuck. And I had already used The Strange Company, which is an homage to the publishing firm, The Strange Company. So I wanted to do The Weird Company, and it just kind of clicked. So that's how we got to The Weird Company.
But one thing, even though it may be what's going on when Lovecraft, when Lovecraft wasn't around, or what Lovecraft didn't describe, you have some major and very clever reinterpretations of things.
Well,
Particularly a certain, I'm not going to say, you've alluded to it before, but I don't want to mention who it is. A certain character who is a villain is now a hero. And when you first threw that out, I couldn't see how you were going to pull it off. But you did. Very brilliantly.
I think that, there's no good and there's no evil. There are people in situations, and you will behave the way you're going to.
Yeah, it's our interpretation of who's a bad guy and who's a good guy. The bad guy, his interpretation when he looks in the mirror is he's just a guy or a woman.
Yeah, or in this case, both.
Yeah.
But yeah, well, one of the things that I'm doing, and I keep doing this, is I keep rereading the source material, and I keep finding things that we've kind of glossed over.
Right.
And, you know, the fact that Ephraim Waite's wife was locked up in the attic until she died, you know, that's kind of glossed over. We kind of forget about that, but I think it's an important part of the story.
And you know what? I'm going to look, I just think that's wrong. It's wrong to lock a woman up in the attic.
That she was locked in the attic until she died?
Yeah, I think that's wrong. I mean, other people may not agree, but I think it's wrong to do that.
Yeah, I mean, look at Norman. Norman didn't lock his mom in the attic. Norman really loved his mommy. He let her, you know, occupy a room in the house.
Sure.
He just locked her in the basement, that's all.
Yeah, that was worse. An attic is, you know, a step up.
You have air in the attic.
I've lived in houses where the basement was better than the attic.
Yeah, in the summer, you don't want to be in the attic, you know.
Yeah.
That like, reminds me, there's a Spanish horror movie called La Residencia. It's also called The House That Screamed, which I've used in some of my stories. And if you ever see it, they literally took Psycho and tried to turn everything around. So, like, instead of ending in the basement, it's going to end in the attic. Instead of the mother being dead, she'll be alive. All, you know, it was like somebody just took it and said, you know, we want to copy it, but we don't want to brazenly copy it.
I'm glad that everybody's enjoying this book, because I put this is the book that I really wanted to write before Reanimators. And now you see why.
It's really good.
Thank you.
It's really good. I'm enjoying the heck out of it.
What part are you at? Just so I remember last.
I'm near the beginning.
Okay.
I just got it in the mail. Like I went camping over the weekend.
You know.
Go
ahead. I'm sorry.
So you haven't gotten to Dr. Wilson's narrative yet.
No, I'm just basically kind of like enjoying the whole. It's just good. I'm liking it. You know, it's like it's going to keep me busy for a week here.
There you go.
Well, there are some clever in jokes in that book too. I had to reread the front page, the opening pages again, and the three gentlemen who that government report was written.
Oh yes. Oh yes.
I don't want to say who they are because it gives away too much. First, I thought you were giving a tribute to a British mythos writer, but now I realize who that one of those people is.
Yep.
I think that people were really looking forward to the sequel because I posted about it on Tuesday. I think you noticed, Pete. And
oh yeah.
It doesn't. Well, I hope it helped, but. The thing is, you know, it doesn't matter how many followers you have. I notice, you know, some books get more response than others. And that, it got quite a large response on Tuesday. And, you know, I could tell that people were really, you know, must have enjoyed Reanimators and were looking forward to reading The Weird Company because of it. So.
One difference between this book and Reanimators, I would say Reanimators was more episodic than this book. This book is more of an integrated novel.
Yes, it is. And, you know, if you look at Reanimators, it takes place over almost 30 years, 25 to 30 years. This one, except for a few flashbacks, it's a week, maybe 10 days. I have to figure out. I have to go look up the timeline. I've had to put all this aside because I now have this piece of paper that runs from my 9-foot ceiling to the floor. It's the timeline and layout for the next book. And you know, everything else has been shoved aside. So
when's the next book come out? No, I'm just curious. I mean, you don't want a year or is
I'm about 40 to 50% done the first book, the next book.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd like to get it done by January or February, and if we do that, then we could be looking at October again.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how do your publishers say you're doing? Are they pleased with sales?
They were very pleased with the pre-orders on this book, on the new book. They're also very pleased that Amazon has sold out on Reanimators, and they have to restock.
Awesome.
So that's why it's gone to 1 to 3 week delivery.
Well, that's good.
So that's kind of nice. All my, you know, and that's with my current publisher, the one publishing house. But as you guys know, whenever anything hits, all the other stuff just takes a little bump too. Not as big, but little things get bumped. I think I've seen even the eZine collection up a little bit.
So, oh, did it?
Yeah, you may not have seen it yet, but I'm obsessive compulsive about it.
I don't pay any attention, to be honest.
Hey, we bro. Have...
kind of like that...
Mm-hmm.
You know that famous exchange between, was it Oscar Wilde and his publisher?
Oh, yeah.
Where Oscar Wilde was worried about his book sales, and he sent him a note, and it was just a question mark. The publisher sent him a note back. It was just an exclamation point.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, I'm kind of the kind of person where if I can pay my bills and buy a book once in a while, I don't, that's really, that I'm happy, you know. So, although I do check the stats every once in a while, but.
Well, you know, it's the age of instant gratification.
Yeah.
I need to know what's going on, but I really don't. And it's going to sound really, really bad, but one of the things I'm trying to do here now is to build a brand and, you know, be someplace in 7 to 12 years.
Well, yeah. I mean, you're working towards a goal. You have to check where you're at along with this goal. We're two different personalities. I'm not knocking the way you look at things.
No.
And, you know... It'd be nice to be able, I'm sure the thoughts crossed your mind, it'd be nice to be able to have enough sales to, that's the way you earn your living, you know?
Well, and in 7 years I'll have, at my current job, 30.
Mm-hmm.
But, so, yeah, we've talked about, you know, I could go right full time, right? Yeah, move. But Mandy's a little nervous about that, rightfully so, because the girls would only be like 13. So she wants me to do another 5 years.
College to think about.
What's that?
Yeah. Yeah. Doesn't have college to think about.
Right. So, you know, if I do another 5 years, I get a $200,000 bonus in my retirement package, which would pay for college.
Mm-hmm.
So that'd be nice.
You also got to worry about your health insurance and other things.
Yes. And that would put me closer to, you know, Social Security and Medicaid if I do that extra 5 years.
So. Yeah, I'm lucky there because my wife has a full-time job, so we have her health insurance.
Well, and that's the other thing. Mandy got the first job she applied for, and she absolutely loves it. She's working part-time now. But maybe by the time we're ready to do this, she'll be ready to, you know, support me with health benefits. So there you go. It's a plan.
Joe and I are working on slowly but surely on on a collection or two of his King and Yellow tales. His beautiful bride's got to double check our current edition, but we hope to have that out sometime soon, right, Joe? Joe.
Computer properly. It's being worked on.
Yeah, Steve Santiago, wasn't it? Did a really nice cover for it.
Oh yeah, great cover.
So, I think we're almost there. We just gotta finish it up.
Yeah, well, if I worked the way regular people worked, it would have been done long ago.
Well, you've got to remember that, you know, he has to wait for the world population of exclamation points to reach a critical threshold.
No. I do not, in my text, use excessive exclamation marks. I don't use excessive punctuation in my text. You know, if you had grown up, if you had grown up on Jack Kirby and rock and roll and E.T. Cummings, you know, then you'd be a card-carrying weirdo too.
I was the only person in high school.
To you, the page is a page. To me, the page is a canvas.
I was the only person in my high school who knew who E.E. Cummings and Bukowski
were. I'm not saying you didn't get exposed to those things. I'm just saying those are not your DNA as a storyteller. You know, you approach the...
You don't have the expertise.
Approach the page.
There,
I got shelves of poetry.
Now you've done it.
Most of it is postmodern hybrid poetry. The page is a canvas.
Can we plug a new author?
Yes, we can. Please do.
Well, I just read this great
novel. I was interested in a new author, especially if they use exclamation points.
Yeah, I just read this new novel, Lucky's Girl.
Oh, how is that? Well, I like that.
Oh, yes, it's wonderful.
Okay.
Yeah, I heard and good things about it.
How are you doing? Is it do you use Bill or William? Should I address
Bill?
Bill is fine, but William on the cover of the book.
Yeah, that's your second book, isn't it, Bill? Or is it third?
Well, it depends on where you start counting, but it's my first one with a like real publisher. So, yeah.
Well, the previous book, I'm sorry, I'm not feeling very well. I know.
Yeah,
I
remember. Immortal Body.
Immortal Body, yes, was very good. It was also Lovecraftian,
yeah.
For those that don't know. So, actually, so, Joe, you'd probably like that one. Sort of a Lovecraftian. I guess you could call it a police procedural, of sorts, right, Bill?
I didn't intend to write one, but that's what people have been describing it as. So, okay, sure.
What part of Texas do you live in again?
Austin.
Because you don't sound like you're from Texas. Well, Austin's not really in Texas.
Well, I'm from Houston originally.
Oh.
But the thing is, if I leave Texas, I get people explain to me that I have this horrifying Texas accent that, you know, could curl your hair, you know. But
I'm just curious, what prompted you to set, what was Lucky Girls in Michigan?
Yeah, that's up in the UP. It's just... I've got cousins in the regular, the lower part of Michigan, and they always talked about the UP as this sort of,
it's different.
Yeah. I went up there and visited it, and it is different. It is like a whole other country within a country.
You know, actually, Bill, there's a mystery series that I really like. It's not a horror series, just mystery, but it's set in this little town called Paradise, Michigan, okay. The Upper Peninsula. It's right on the almost right on the border of with Canada.
Yeah.
And you know, protagonist really loves the winters up there. You know, so which most people don't, but see, the first one's called Another Day in Paradise, but it talks a lot about the area is almost like another character in the book. So I know exactly what you're talking about. I've not been up there, but it makes you want to go up there, especially if you like winter like I do.
Well, it's a stunningly beautiful place. It's just kind of in a sense, you know, the most desolate and abandoned part. You know, you could argue the most abandoned.
Yeah,
part.
Yeah, you know what? In several parts of the books, he calls it. Living on the edge of the world.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. So, Rick, did you like it?
Yeah. Roll violent.
A little violent?
What was it? No, I was saying I liked the location. Grove Island was the place you invented.
Oh, okay.
But by the way, you use this incantation over and over again, and I can't remember. It began with a K, something like Chematox. Is that something you just came up with as your own, or does that have its origin somewhere?
I made that up. I just made
okay.
But
nothing
you know,
wrong with that. I just wanted to be sure.
I wanted it to sound, you know, sort of, you know, kind of from what, you know, Lovecraftian perspective, what a proto-language would sound like. So it's just syllables, you know. Mm-hmm. That's what it is, really. I guess we're just using syllables, too, but, you know, I digress.
Are you suspended in the air, or is that a poster behind you?
That is a poster. That is a poster. I did that on purpose because my office is not set up and it would look kind of cheesy having empty bookshelves.
Oh, okay.
Especially with this crowd, so yeah.
What city is it?
Come on, Rick has a toilet behind him, so you know.
Yeah.
I think that's New York in like the 30s.
No, it's not a problem. Well, it's
the Triangle Building right behind you, isn't it?
Yeah, that's New York in like the 1930s, something like that.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
Well, I see
Bill, just to make you feel good, I am about ankle deep in underwear.
Oh, we all wanted to know that.
I'm not sure if that's the perfect segue, but I wanted to show something off to the kids, the cool kids. that
is the perfect segue, actually.
That arrived in the mail. So.
Is that one of those copies where you get a pair of autographed underwear?
Actually, that's not a bad marketing tie-in.
No, it's not. You know, and Pete's got extra special plans for the free gift you'll get along with Reanimatrix.
Yes.
But your wife may not approve.
Reanimatrix is a little bit of a bondage angle to it.
You may have to get permission from your wife to be able to order that package when it comes along.
All I can think about is we watched Blues Brothers the other night, and all I can think about is the opening when he's getting all his stuff back. One new, unopened, one slightly soiled.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, both times.
I don't know. This book sounds like it's going to be like The Love Dead by Lovecraft and Eddie.
There's a little bit, there's a little bit of C.M. Eddie in this, and I'm not going to deny that. I'm having a lot of fun with it. It's just, I spent the day rereading Dreams in the Witch House because there's a murder in that book that I think has been completely unexplored by anybody, and I'm gonna write about it.
You're talking about the boy, or
yeah, the boy.
Hmm.
Speaking of the Dreams in the Witch House, just have to plug the HPHLS. Their rock opera. They did release two Dreams in the Witch House things recently. One of their radio plays. But their rock opera is really good. Really good libretto. Maybe I'm a fuddy-duddy, but I really like the music, too. And the singing was very good. It was quite entertaining. Anyway,
I'm looking for it. I have it someplace. I plug it into the TV, and I listen to it.
It's really good, isn't it? I enjoy the heck out of it.
I mean, it's not exactly 100% faithful to the book, but I don't expect any adaption, whether it be film, play, or music, to be like that. Really well done.
They were streaming last night too from the LA HP Lovecraft Film Festival. They were streaming. I only found out like when they were almost done. They were doing Shadow Over Innsmouth, I believe, live.
Oh man, that would have been great.
I know. I wish they would have told me. I would have passed it on to everybody. But I only accidentally found out when like they had 15 minutes left. So I caught it for a few minutes. It was pretty cool.
Mm-hmm. They do great work.
Yeah.
Well, you know, one thing interesting there, regular adaptation of Dreams in the Witch House fit in very well with the angle that Pete used in The Weird Company.
Oh, yeah.
You know, Frank Elwood, I mean, you know, the note that the drama ended on fit in very well where you picked up Elwood.
Yeah. Yes.
Before I forget, speaking of The Weird Company, I promised that I would give away 3 copies of The Weird Company. I should say we, because they came from Pete. And 7 copies of print editions of the Lovecraft eZine to random people who commented on issue 32 on the website, which is the latest issue. And as usual, I've gotten a little behind, haven't done that yet, but I'm going to pick all those people out randomly Monday or Tuesday and notify them. So if you want a chance to win The Weird Company or a print copy of Lovecraft eZine, you still got a chance if you haven't yet commented on the
those are proofs.
Yeah, but it's still the book.
Yeah, I mean, still the book, but they're uncorrected proofs. Yeah, they're a little smaller in size, and they've got all the mistakes I made.
No,
well, let's put it this way. When you're Stephen King famous, these proofs are going to be worth a lot of money. So,
any time I've ever gotten an uncorrected proof from at least a professional publisher, like, I mean, I remember The Hound Hunters by Adam Neswander was available as uncorrected proofs. You know, it took a long while to be professionally published. It got canceled, and then it came out like a decade later.
Yeah.
They've been pretty good, you know.
Yeah, so is The Weird Company.
Yeah. Yeah, it was pretty close to done.
I mean, Pete, they took out a lot of it. You notice, if you look at the uncorrected proof and then the published version, there's a lot less exclamation points in the published version. So they took a lot of those out. But other than that...
You know, I'm going to get these copyrighted.
Well, I still think there is literally a pulver flavor to the book.
I haven't yet to read it. You know, nobody wanted me to order the copy that came with the underpants. Oh, and the copies for this giveaway, ladies and gentlemen, there are no underwear coming.
Right.
Right.
Sorry. The underwearless package.
I need every...
And you know, come to think of it, I'm glad I'm the old guy here and I'll croak fairly soon. Because I'm
afraid... You still have sex appeal. I mean, I don't... I know everyone agrees with me.
But you know what I'm really afraid of is Rollick's, like, 7th book. I'll be, you know, dirt in the ground. So I won't have to worry about it.
2 weeks from now.
You know, when he comes out, and I'm not sure what he's going to title the book, but, you know, he'll be starting to look at old age... And I think
Underwear Cthulhu.
He'll probably put that book out with Depends or something.
I already have the next 2 Mythos books that I want to write. I already have titles for. Mm-hmm. So.
What's the title after Reanimatrix?
I really want to do a collect. I've got about 10 stories about Professor Peasley and his family. I want to do a book called The Peasley Papers.
Okay.
That covers almost 1 million years of life on planet Earth. Yeah. And then after that, I want to do a series of stories called Randolph Carter, Warlock of Yadin.
Can we just agree that the ending for The Statement of Randolph Carter is about the cheesiest ever?
It is kind of cheesy, but it's fun. In a fun way.
Well, you know, it's written early in Lovecraft.
Yeah.
You know, you go to the early Lovecraft. You go to the early Lovecraft stuff like Statement of Randolph Carter, Herbert West, or whatever. You know, you're gonna find things easy.
It's funny because I've been looking at some of the stories, and I've come to realize that in some ways, Shadow over Innsmouth is a rewrite of the facts in the case of the late Arthur German and his family.
Yeah, I agree with that.
I'll buy that.
And also a little bit of Dagon, too.
And mixed up with a little bit of Dagon, right. And I will also say that I think that the Lurking Fear has been rewritten as Rats in the Wall.
Yeah, I can see that.
I could buy that. I'd buy that for a dollar.
So I've been looking at these stories and I'm seeing these same patterns over and over again. I'm like, maybe he just rewrote the same story, three or four times.
Well, I think what happens is you get an idea, you do it early as a writer, and
right, and then you want to go back and do it again.
More talented, you can do justice to the same thing, mix it up a little bit.
Well, Willems revisited things like that. I have.
Readers don't mind it either because, you know, they love a certain theme and they want to see variations on the theme.
Right.
Yeah.
But to me, it's interesting that in the first story of with Arthur German, when you find out that you're inhuman, that part of your past is, and this goes back to the talk we had last week, when you find out that part of your genetic makeup is not human, apparently the proper response is to set yourself on fire. But 20 or 30 years later, when you rewrite that story, the proper response is to just accept it and dwell in wandering glory forever.
Yeah.
I mean, those are two different, very different endings to the same story. And it's an interesting take over where the author might be mentally.
Mm-hmm. That's good. Yeah. I never thought about it that way.
Mental authors?
Yeah, we're all mental. In the future,
is that currently being allowed by law?
No.
Aren't those people being prosecuted or at least rounded up and put into camps?
Yeah.
Pete, by the way, I need I need one more story for issue 32, so I'll put a sense of time in there.
Oh, great. You like that, huh?
Well, I'm sure I will when I read it. Oh. I'm kidding. Yeah, I read it. I liked it. Yeah, got it right in front of me here.
Mike, don't do that to me. I can't start selling stories sight unseen. You know, that's just not...
No.
Over there going, yeah, you can. Yeah.
No, there's no problem with rewriting a variation on a theme, but it becomes problematic if an author essentially takes the same story and doesn't change it that much.
Yeah, right. Dean Koontz is a bad example.
Right.
Well, just to go into the pulp era, E. Hoffman Price, Lovecraft's friend, when he really needed to make money after he lost his job in the 1930s, was taking everything that he sold to Weird Tales in the 20s and was rewriting it for Spicy Mystery. This is true. I wrote at least for an amateur magazine, a huge article, and I could match up story by story. Yeah. They just threw in sex. I mean, the characters' names change, but the plot is the same.
Yeah, a lot of Dean Koontz stories, you know, you've got these two damaged people, something bad's happened in their past, and then they meet.
Don't forget the dog.
Yeah, you always got to have a dog, yeah.
Golden retriever.
Yeah.
Yeah, or black lab, but usually a retriever.
Yeah.
And a lot of times the dog is really super intelligent in at least two to three stories. So.
Yeah, in fact, there was a point where I thought that Dean Koontz was actually a pseudonym for the guy who wrote Fluke.
Fluke?
Something Herbert.
James?
A British writer. James Herbert.
James Herbert.
Because it's kind of the same kind of story. There's a dog. He's super intelligent.
Yeah. And, of course, now lately, the last 5 or 10 years, he's on this evolution is wrong kick, and He's thrown that into a lot of his books.
Right.
So, I used to like him. I mean, he was kind of like a guilty pleasure, you know what I mean? But
are we talking about Koontz or?
Koontz, yeah.
No, we're talking about Rollick.
Dude, guilty pleasure. Killed to be a guilty pleasure.
Back to, yeah, but Koontz originally, when he reappeared in, what was it, Dangerous Visions Again?
Mm-hmm.
Harlan had crowned him as one of the... This is going to be a biggie, folks.
Yeah.
Well, he's definitely a biggie.
Harlan
didn't mean it that way.
Oh. No, but he's not writing quality stuff. That's a nice way I can put it.
Yeah, I know that...
No, but I bet you all his homes on the various beaches around the world are pretty nice.
Yeah, from what I understand, he doesn't leave home much in L.A.
Well, he probably doesn't have to. You know, he can probably afford to type in his grocery list and have it delivered. Don't they do that on Rodeo Drive? You know, you like type in, you know, I don't want Heinz ketchup. I want that, you know, one that comes from Naples, you know, the import, you know, the 32-ounce bottle.
It's called Schwann's, isn't it? When you get
Schwann's.
You know?
Yeah. All right, so what else can we talk about? Let's see.
Murray... It's not mythos, but he has been authorized to write a new Tarzan novel.
That's interesting.
Well, Will owns that stuff.
Well, the Burroughs Estate just licensed him. He's going to write a novel set during World War II, which is a sequel to Tarzan and Terrible, which was set during World War I. So it would be interesting how he handles that.
Well, I got something to talk about.
I do too, but you go ahead first, Joe. I got something interesting too. Go ahead.
Copies of this show showed up.
Oh, yay!
And it's called The Year's Best Weird Fiction, Volume 1, edited by Laird Barron, published by Michael Kelly and Undertow Books, and it's a summation of the year's best weird fiction as opposed to horror or whatever. It's going to be an annual series with rotating editors. So this year was selected by Laird. Next year, Kathy Koja is the editor. That'll be interesting. And this volume, and this is all in some way, shape, or form, pertains to some people on this screen. This volume contains a story by Livia Llewellyn. I don't know who she is. A story that I was the proud papa of, or uncle, or godfather, or whatever, as she wrote it for the Grim Scribes Puppets, and it was nominated for a Shirley Jackson Award. It also has a story in here by Scott Nicolay called I Exchange Bank, which appeared in the Grim Scribes Puppets, as well as his new debut collection. It has something by someone named Joseph S. Pulver Sr. that actually was published in an issue of Lovecraft eZine.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought that was pretty cool.
Which story was that?
It was my tribute to Willem. He dreams... Hang on, I don't remember the name. What the hell was
Lovecraft and horror, wasn't it?
He dreams of Lovecraftian horror?
Yeah, I think so.
I just write them, and then I move on to the next one. I don't, you know... There's, you know, man, you got Jeffrey Ford, Richard Gavin, Langan. I don't like John Langan. You know, there's this great word cloud up there, and John Langan is one of those that steals all the good words.
But not the exclamation points!
I know it's funny. Paul Tremblay's in here, Jeff Vandermeer's in here, Simon Stranzis is in here. I can't stand Simon Stranz's. You know, he does something that I'm completely unable to do, and I hate him for it.
So, Joe, is there somebody you do like?
Yeah, I like you just fine.
Wait, that's the kiss.
You know, well, no, Stranz's ability to do disquieting is amazing. I mean, and it baffles me to no end because I don't do
Right.
A master at it. It's like he oozes it. But I don't want to talk about him because I don't like Simon Stranz. Yes, I finally got a copy here in Berlin of Stranz's new collection, which, mark my words, this will be on those up for nomination lists next year. the guy's really good. But back to this one. Who did we miss? Damien Angelica Walters is in here. And Karin Tidbeck, who's mind-blowing. Just, wow. How do some of these people do this? You know, they are just so subtle. Ooh. Thrilling, thrilling. But, yeah, finally, I was absolutely thrilled to be in this. Thank you, Laird. Thank you, Mike Kelly. But, good book. And like I said, it's got Livy in it. So anytime it's got Livy in it, it's a good book. Even if she's got to bring along some of these other people with her, you know, they're okay too.
All the people you hate, right?
Well, mostly I just hate Stranzis and Langen.
Okay.
Because they consistently do things I'm not able to do. You know, I don't hate you at all. You know, it's like. I'm not as talented as you, of course, but...
I would not say that at all.
We both play with dangerous language.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I mean, I consider you like a cousin. You know, you're the talented one, I'm like the mascot, but, you know, so...
Mm. No, I think we're both equally talented. We just apply our talents in very different ways to a lot of...
Yeah, different
some
ways.
Some subjects with some similar... language and imagery.
Yeah. And we're interested in, I don't know, I'll say modern, postmodern. Whereas some of these people are, well, Langen's whatever the hell he wants to be. I think Langen's range is vast. And like I said, Simon just, since I don't know how many years it's been, but quite a number of years. His stuff is just eerie. It just bothers me. So I'll stop bitching about Simon Stranz. Wait for the email, you know, that says something nasty.
Well, apparently they're reprinting A Look Behind the Derleth Mythos. Origins of the Cthulhu Mythos.
Mm-hmm.
And an instant classic when first released, blah, blah, blah. Here's the part I like. Does the Cthulhu Mythos... I'm reading from the Amazon synopsis. Does the Cthulhu Mythos owe its existence to the Lovecraft Mythos? Or is the parallel fictional world of Derleth Mythos even more influential? Comparatively shallow works, such as S.T. Joshi's The Rise and Fall of the Cthulhu Mythos, are filled with misconceptions and tell only a small part of this hotly controversial story. So, I posted about this on the Facebook page a few days ago, and
sure, you just people were like,
yeah, well, you know, when it came out, S.T. was really harsh on the book, and I was like, well... I have no doubt. But I don't get all this, let's bash somebody else to sell a book.
Well, the thing is, when Joshi, did you read The Rise and Fall of the Cthulhu Mythos? I don't read much criticism. I like reading the stories. I barely got time to read these days, so I'd rather...
Yeah, I've glanced at it.
But I read this book, okay, because I think when it first came out, no, maybe a few years later, he eviscerated Brian Lumley.
Mm-hmm.
He called.
But he's always done that. He did that in HPL Life.
No, but he in print, he called him a talentless hack.
Yeah, he's been doing that since day one.
And it was like, holy shimoly, you don't think someone's going to turn the knife on you?
Yeah. And I'm not saying that Joshi doesn't probably deserve to get some back. I'm just saying, why are we doing this at all in our little subgenre, you know? Why do we have to do this?
Yeah, and just to say, Lumley, whatever his strengths or faults are, is a talented writer.
Yeah.
Particularly in Necroscope, where he perfected his craft.
Well, read Demogorgon. Demogorgon's a damn good book. Skip what you think about Cthulhu Mythos or whatever. If you're just going to pick a Lumley title to read, and you're going to like go through it with a red pen, you know, critically, Demogorgon's a really, really fine book. You know, and for me, being the age I am, you know, 29 still, you know, when things like Spawn of the Abyss were coming out and whatnot, damn good yarn, it was a hell of a lot of fun. There's nothing wrong with that. Some days I want a pizza. You know, I read Beckett, I read Borges, I read...
Didn't he blast Jeff, though, in that book, too?
Yeah.
Jeff, me, well, that part of the book, ST used to have a column in Weird Tales, something den, in the den, whatever, and there was a column 1 month where he reviewed Willem, Ann Schwader, Stan Sargent, Joe Pulver, Jeff Thomas, and I believe Paul Berglund. And he raved about Willem. He was very, very nice to Ann. And I got gutted. Jeff got gutted. Paul Berglund got gutted. You know, it's like there were two positives and the rest were, you know.
Well, this goes back to, he was like...
I stopped writing for 2 years after that review. It's like, wow, this is the big gun. This is the powerhouse.
This gets back to, like, you talk about him wanting to own the pond. Okay.
Yeah.
At that point, he was thinking, no one should be writing Lovecraftian fiction at all, really. He didn't think it was a worthwhile avenue to explore.
That's correct.
That those of us who were really kind of like, I'm sure I was wider read in the those kind of stories than him at that point, because I think there are so many great stories coming out. Yeah, sure, there's a lot of dross and crap and authors I don't like. Some of their stuff, and like, but there were so many good stories I could pick out just to say, how could you read this and not enjoy it? And it was like he was deliberately not enjoying it. And now I think he's just turned around and he's changed his tune a bit.
Well, he's done
the job of the academic to act like they're too good for the subject matter.
Okay, he's actually gone from there is no Cthulhu Mythos, and there shouldn't be, and he's done a 180. I mean, he even has a criteria for what makes a Cthulhu Mythos story nowadays. He is publishing, you know, everything from Black Wings to other Lovecraftian anthologies that do indeed include, quote-unquote, from him, Cthulhu Mythos work. A Mountain Walk, which will
comes
be out here
this
in a
week.
Okay.
Dipping this week.
But here's the story behind A Mountain Walk. A Mountain Walk was originally going to come out from Mythos Books. Okay? The email I had from ST, I had sent him something for, because he was working on a couple anthologies, and I sent him a story, and in case it fit. Because he's like, if you come up with something, let me know. So I sent him something. And his original email, and this is six years ago, was, I'm going to put this book out, and it's going to be, you know, S.T. Joshi's Best of the Cthulhu Mythos. It's going to be mostly reprints with a couple original things. And I'm not sure of the title yet. The title soon became Spawn of the Green Abyss. But at that particular point, he wasn't 100% sure of the title. And he was looking at 14 or 15 reprints, you know, that he considered these are the finest Cthulhu Mythos stories ever written. And he had an original work by me, an original story by Donald Tyson, and an original story by Cody Goodfellow that he thoroughly loved and thought all three were brilliant, and he was going to add them to this book. So that book was being worked on. There was actually a table of contents for it. And then problems happened at Mythos Books, and the book didn't happen through them. And ultimately, the book wound up at Centipede Press. Well, in this period of time, ST had begun doing Black Wings. And Jared Walters at Centipede Press said, you know, we're going to do this book, you know, this your version of the best Cthulhu Mythos stories. Why don't we expand it? Because you've got access to all these writers, and you're getting submissions all the time, and we'll turn it into something like Black Wings. And I think the book is currently over 700 pages. They joke about calling it the cube because it's, you know, as thick as it is high.
Mm-hmm.
And I've seen the table of contents, but I've forgotten. I believe there's like 40 writers. And so you have like those 15 original reprints, and then virtually all the rest is brand new material. So here was a book that, I don't know, I'll say it was, this is 14, so 6 or 7 years after the rise and fall of the Cthulhu mythos, where ST pretty much says there is no mythos and there shouldn't be, ST was going to do Spawn of the Green Abyss, which was going to be his best of the Cthulhu mythos. So he's completely changed his mind about, you know, and like I said, I believe it's one of Paula Guran's Lovecraft books actually prints ST's criteria, and there's 5 points, and I don't remember them off the top of my head. But here's his criteria for what what is a Cthulhu mythos story. So he's completely changed his mind. In part, that's softening. In part, I also think that there's a market that's opened up that he didn't see before. The other thing with ST is, if we look at the beginning of his career, here was an extremely passionate Lovecraftian who was trying, who had one goal, and that was to make Lovecraft an American author of letters. And ST finally achieved that through a lot of hard work, through a mountain of research, you know, his biography, all those, you know, essays and whatnot. Mm-hmm. So once he had gotten Lovecraft established, you know, and didn't have to worry about that anymore, ST could reapply his focus. What am I going to do now, kind of thing. And that's when ST began to look around and began editing new stuff. ST, I think, also, the realization hit him that he worked with and knew a lot of living writers who were in this pond and who were passionate, who he thought were talented, and, you know, he could be editing books by these people. He could, you know, come up with a theme and say, you know, Willem and...
Suddenly it is okay that there's a Cthulhu mythos and we're still... Suddenly it's okay? Because there's a...
He changed his mind. Well,
changed his mind.
Is entitled,
cash on the market.
It sounds like anybody's
entitled to change their mind.
Yeah. You're absolutely right. Everyone's entitled to change their minds. But, man, he sure packs a lot of negative emotion in some of those reviews.
Yeah, he does go over the top. He's always confessed that occasionally his passions get the better of him. I think it weakens him as a reviewer and a critic because, you know, to come out and say, you know, this guy's nothing but a hack is, I don't, you know, even if you're displeased with the work.
And that's what I'm saying, Joe. He's certainly entitled to change his mind. In fact, changing your mind, realizing you're wrong about something is a very mature thing to do. But when you said it weakens him as a reviewer and as a critic, it does. I can't take anyone's opinion seriously, ever, that says the Jeff Thomas or Joel Pulver is a crappy writer, in so many words.
I can understand how somebody would... Okay, I'll be short, Pete, I promise. I can understand how somebody might not like my work. I'm not saying I'm as good as Cisco, but like a Cisco, I'm not for everybody.
Right.
I wish Cisco and I and a bunch of other writers I could name were, I don't know, more reader friendly. That's the wrong way to put it, but I wish we were for everybody.
That's definitely the wrong way to put it. I mean, those stories, they'll take you by the throat.
Well, that's our job.
No.
Willem said it repeatedly. What the intent of literature is, you're sitting there in your chair. You went out and spent your money, and you got my book in your hand. My job, not when I was writing this stuff, because I shouldn't be concerned with you when I'm working, but at the end, my job is to fuck you up. I don't mean that in a bad way. I mean, you went to work, you traded your valuable time for money, you invested it in art.
Mm-hmm.
You shouldn't be reading, see Dick throw the ball to Spot.
Well, and if Joe Pulver does not appeal to a certain reader for whatever reason, that doesn't mean that he's a hack or his writing is crap. And I'm not picking on ST. I don't like the way that ST reviews people, but at the same time, I don't like seeing a book on Amazon dissing ST another of ST's works. I mean, why do we got to do this? You know, like, I mean, fucking grow up, Jesus Christ!
Right.
I mean, why do we got to pack all this negative emotion into everything? Why can't we do our jobs as editors, writers, and critics without saying, "Oh, this guy sucks," you know?
I do need to say one thing. It's kind of very tangential. This book had sold out at the publisher, but if there are viewers out there who want to spend the money, ST on his blog mentioned he had a copy or two to sell, and so did Subterranean Press.
Which book?
A Mountain Walk.
Okay.
Oh.
So if you are listening and you're interested, those would be the places to go first.
And actually, I think ST's couple of copies of Mountain Walk he was selling for $1.50, which is almost like stealing it.
That's the price that ended up on Centipede.
Oh, did it? I thought it was going to be like, originally I heard things like $250 bandied about.
Yeah, and now down on Amazon it's $156.
Oh. And the thing is that's bad about those. I mean, it's cool being in the book, but you know, you want to be read.
Yeah.
You know, give me a $20 paperback that those people out there can afford to buy. I mean, I don't want a $59 book. Somebody goes, Joe Pulver, $59. You know, let the goddamn thing be $15, $20 where somebody can afford this. You know, it's like, oh, that looks interesting. I'll take a shot.
Right.
I'm writing to be read.
Right.
You know?
So you're not Margaret Atwood?
No. I want to wake up tomorrow morning and be J.K. Rowling. You know, but don't laugh, because then I'll be taking care of a bunch of
people. I think Libby's the only one who got the joke.
Why? I'll take a hit. If I could figure out how to write something that would sell, I'd write it. I could be a whore.
Wow.
Hey, can I segue into something I wanted to talk about?
Yes, please do.
That's also a segue for me to leave, because I now have to sign off so I can go write something that I need to sell or finish writing. Finish
what are you writing, Livia?
What?
What are you writing?
It's...
Oh, never mind. I'm not going to put you on the spot.
Does it have a title?
Yeah, it's called
Breach. Can we hear the title?
Yeah, the title is Breach.
Okay.
And you know when whales breach the surface and they rise right up out of the water and...
Why was I thinking Breach Birth?
Do you want to see all my Dan Beachy QuickBooks? Do I know about Breach
Birth too? I realize Breach has two meanings, but in this case, think of something absolutely gigantic and horrifying rising up out of the water.
Awesome.
Good night, everyone.
I got out of the shower.
I thought a breach of security was the first thing I thought of.
No, not it's not a shower story.
Well, thank you for being here, Olivia. Appreciate it.
I'll see you later.
Go write your story.
Bye, Olivia.
Bye, Olivia.
Matt.
Okay.
Yeah.
This is September 28th, which means two more days of September, which means...
I can't...
It is getting near October country.
October.
Yeah.
It means a couple things. It means we can talk about, are you going to do an autumn issue for Lovecraft eZine this year of related stories? What is going to come out in autumn Cthulhu? And can someone please send me a list of what are the essential Ray Bradbury Halloween stories or October stories? Because I'm having a hard time getting a complete list.
Well, I don't know that they're all Halloween stories, but the October country is the first one that comes to mind.
Yep.
That's a really, really good collection. God, I mean, I love Ray Bradbury stuff. Really do. But I'd start with the October country.
So tell us about Autumn Cthulhu.
Well, you don't know what else is... I mean, it's... I'm reading submissions for it. I invited a lot of authors, and then I opened it up to the general public. I'm reading those, and I'm going to come out before fall of next year. So, you know, basically it's Lovecraftian stories with that Halloween or autumn feel to them, you know. I don't want to say anything about Pete's story, but actually Pete's story was the first one I accepted, and it's a really good example of it, of what I was looking for.
And a real deviation from my normal work. It's more of a... It's a very subtle... You don't realize what's going on until the end.
Yeah, and as a matter of fact, it's funny that you bring up Ray Bradbury, because I've never even thought about this till just now, but you know, if Ray Bradbury wrote a Lovecraftian story, that's probably another example of what I'm looking for. So that's what Autumn Cthulhu is going to be. I am being extremely picky. So, and yeah, you said that Night in a Lonesome October is being reprinted?
Well, no, I was just wondering if you're going to do another themed issue for Lovecraft eZine about it this year.
No, not this year. It just didn't work out. But the two, anyone interested, the two previous years, the October issue, you can read Night in a Lonesome October themed stories. So.
And are you going to do a Halloween show with Scott Thomas?
Yeah, Scott and Jeff, actually.
Oh, nice.
That's great. So
I think that's going to be on... I need to announce to everybody. I think that's going to be on the 30th. So, but I'll announce that. Hang on 1 second here. Yeah, here's the email. Yep, the 30th. We just got to nail down a time. Probably something like 7 or 8 Eastern.
So, if we're talking about future projects.
Mm-hmm.
In I guess the cat's out of the bag. I've mentioned it here a couple times, but hopefully by the time Necronomicon 2015 rolls around, the Legacy of the Reanimator, a collection of Reanimator stories, will be released through Chaosium. Brian Sammons and I put this together. It will include the original Herbert West Reanimator by H.P. Lovecraft and the two Bob Price round robins, which included a whole bevy of people, including Rod Heather, Michael Sisko, Joel Pulver, Brian McNaughton,
C.J. Henderson.
C.J. Henderson. This absolutely fabulous collection of stories.
I still remember the Calums where we were reading our parts of Reanimated to each other.
Matt, you got some music going on there?
Sorry, I thought I had muted it. Sorry. It's actually related. I'm posting it on the eZine webpage. Never mind.
Oh, okay. What were you saying, Joe?
I said, I actually remember after, you know, I mean, Bob had pitched it right there in his living room while we were all sitting there. And whether you wanted to be in or not, we were there, so we were drafted. And then over the course of the next few months, we actually sat there and read our chapters to each other, which was in some ways a lot of fun and in some ways scary as hell when you were sandwiched in between who you were sandwiched in between.
So would I include...
I love the idea that this stuff's all being collected finally. I mean, I'm thrilled that I got to be a very small part of any part of this. But a lot of this stuff disappears. Years ago, I did a round robin, Tom Willock, Tom Ligotti, John Ford, me, a bunch of guys. And it's a great, great round robin. And this thing came out in a small British zine, and it's never appeared again. You know, it was like, I was talking to Cisco, and it's like, hey, I got this thing, and it's interesting, and I was going to write a story, but I was thinking, I'd like to see a round robin. You want to, and so Cisco wrote part two, and then we asked Ligotti. I knew he was going to say no, but he said, oh, yeah, sure. And it's like, okay, well, he goes, who do you want me to send it to? I don't know. Well, who do you think? And he goes, oh, my buddy Tom Willett would be great. You know, it's like, it just turned into this really, I think, fantastic
Can I just throw out that I think you're making an extremely good point about this stuff not disappearing. We don't want the stuff to disappear. And for my own small part, if there's stuff out there that is extremely obscure, send it my way. You know, maybe I can republish it. And I mean, I'm doing this for Joe and several other people, trying to get Scott Thomas, for example, trying to get some. In Scott's case, is a good example. Some stories that aren't well known, get them out there, and you know, I could republish some of this stuff under the Lovecraft eZine Press because I don't want it to disappear either. You know.
My mind was blown because Cisco and Ligotti is part of a round robin.
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever think you'd hear about, you know, unless you came across it?
Right.
That's not the kind of thing you think is ever going to happen. You know,
so yeah, no, Mike, if you're looking,
I think it's a great idea that Pete and Brian are rescuing this. So,
You know, and I'll say this about that. When I wrote Reanimators, I was very careful to not only be faithful to the original story, but also to the two sequels, Reanimated and Reincarnated? Reincarnated.
Yeah.
And I was lucky enough to have these and actually know that they existed. And when the idea came up, and the idea of what to put in the book came up, we said, well, we have to put these stories in, these two round robins. Because they've been languishing in obscurity. You have to have, like, really old copies of Crypt of Cthulhu.
Yeah, and well, one of them was in parts, if I remember correctly.
One chapter was in parts. The magazine parts, not parts. But they were all eventually in Crypt of Cthulhu as standalone issues. So yeah, we wanted to do that, and then I wanted to highlight, you know, some of the things that were done by other authors. So we got Molly Tanzer to let us reprint a piece, and Glenn Owen Brass and Ron Shiflett we got theirs. Tim Curran, we got a piece from him, and then we had some space. So we put out a very, very small invitation to see what some people could do. And I'm really impressed with the people, what people produced, including Rick Lai and Christine Morgan. So awesome. We're pretty happy. Oh, and Richard Lee Byers, who is a really great author of genre novels, who just has never been asked to write a Lovecraftian piece before. Hmm. There you go.
When did you say it comes out?
We're going to try to have it out in time for Necronomicon.
You know, there were two things that tend to get lost, round robins, and the other was a change, and I can understand why it happened. In the Robert E. Howard estate, they didn't like all these continuations of Robert E. Howard fragments that got published. But some of them are very good.
Sure.
Stuff that Ramsey Campbell did for Solomon Kane is excellent.
Mm.
Bob Price's one that was in Nameless Cults is very well done. And I know you're apologetic about it, Joe, but the one you did too that was a rough draft is very worthwhile.
I appreciate that. Thank you. But, well, I just, you know, you know how I yelled at Bob over that? I mean, apparently, Bob told me it was Howard's first draft, the fragment. So I wrote this thing thinking, okay, well, you know, I got roped into this, and here's my idea. What do you think? Oh, this is really great. Okay, so I didn't think that. I mean, his thinking was it was Howard's first draft, Hughes Pulver's first draft. you know, and you know, I saw a couple people bitch, you know, it's like, well, you know, this reads like a first draft, and that was Bob's intent, you know, finish first draft. You know, I would have liked to have smoothed it out, but that opportunity never came up.
Well, I would like to see an anthology collecting all the Howard fragments completed by other writers and just recognize saying, this is not Howard. These are what other writers did. Some of it was, you know, commercial, like the Camp and Carter were doing.
Yeah.
And you can judge for yourself, you know, but you do have a completed story now, and you can judge for yourself. Some of them are great. Some of them are okay. Some fragments have been completed. There are two different versions of how they've been completed. Mm-hmm. And he completed some Cormac the Pirates novelettes, and then another writer ended up doing a different version. Put all these together. Because some of them are great, some of them are not so great, but, you know, I don't think they should be lost. They are part of Howard fandom.
Yeah. It'd be interesting. Yeah.
You know, we just isolate them from the bulk of the regular Howard work rather than mix them in like the Camp and Carter did.
Hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot of older stuff I'd like to see rescued. And the thing is, you know, I mean, I start reading Lovecraft, you know, in, what, 69 or 70. There's, you know, Rick, there's a lot of guys our age who start there. But there's people of different ages. You got people who just started Lovecraft in the 80s. You got people who started Lovecraft 15 years ago. We got all kinds of people who, more recently, let's say in the last year or two, are just starting to get into this, you know, and they don't know about this stuff, they haven't heard about this stuff.
You know, even at the very, very, very minimum, if it was republished on Kindle, and print would be great too. I'm not saying it wouldn't be, but even at the very minimum, if a lot of this stuff got republished on Kindle, that would be awesome.
Yeah.
Make it available.
And some of this stuff is just hard to track down. Period. No matter what, you know, was in, you know, Crypto Cthulhu 66, or you know, it was in Midnight Shambler 5, or you know, wherever.
Amanita Brandy.
Yeah, Lynn Carter had a James Allison fragment by Robert E. Howard that he completed called The Tower at the Edge of Time, which is not easy to find. I think it's an issue of Fantastic.
You could do a complete volume of just collected Lovecraftian poetry.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my God, yes. But you know how huge that would have to be if it's being done properly?
I know. I mean, this is my working copy of the bibliography in Concordance. And if you can see this, you can see what I've highlighted is what I have.
Hmm.
And there are some pages that are complete, and then there are pages like this where I have nothing.
Then,
and I'm working at it.
There's no way anybody in their lifetime will get all those books.
Not even
the author of that book has all those.
Yes. In fact, I discovered when in doing the Reanimator anthology that some things that were included in this book actually never saw the light of day. They were never published.
Well, that happens, and we know how well that works, Pete.
Yeah.
And let me go on record that I think it's an absolute travesty that we don't have a massive Lovecraftian poetry tome. There is so much. The problem, The problem is, if it were to happen, let me raise my paw right now as somebody who'd be upset with it. Because I think that's a book that would require more than one editor, and it would require a couple of editors with extremely different tastes, or else the book is going to get tilted in a single direction and be an insult and a failure to Lovecraftian fandom.
Do you think it would sell?
I almost think that would have to be put out. There's two ways I could see this being put out. One would be by Hippocampus Press. They could probably pull it off. They've got the specialized interest. They were going to put out, I've been aching to see it, but I think it's been sidelined, a definitive annotated fungi from Yugoff, which never got released. I think, was it Schultz was going to do the annotations? I forget. The other thing is, there is a complete poetry of Robert E. Howard book that came out a few years ago by basically one of the societies dedicated to his interest. So if you could persuade the folks at a society like the H.P. Lovecraft Historical Society, and I know this isn't up their alley, they might sponsor such a book.
Well, the thing is the book is going to be as expensive as hell. It would be a major undertaking if it's done properly by the editors, because you're going to have to go far and wide. There's going to be estates that I don't even know if there are estates for. It's going to have to be a mammoth book. And there are decisions you're going to have to make as to what you might allow. It's like, let's just, King and Yellow poetry. Are you going to, if this is a volume of Lovecraftian poetry, are you going to, you know, the King in Yellow, due to derelict, due to gaming, has become part of Lovecraftian literature. Now, I'm one of those who's opposed to that. But
I always thought it was because the author lists were very similar. You know, people who like that like the other.
I understand that. Ann Schwader has written a bunch of King in Yellow poetry because she wrote it so I would shut up. You know.
Did it work?
Pardon me?
Did it work?
Yeah, sort of, but then I keep going back to the well. I mean, let's face it, Anne is the preeminent Lovecraftian poet. No ifs, ands, or buts. Her work is head and shoulders above anyone, with the exception of Tierney. You know, but is the King in Yellow included? If you're going to include the King in Yellow, are you going to go back to that Richard Starrett poem that was in Weird Tales? There's all kinds of decisions. It's poetry, so it has to appear properly, which is does things to page counts. You probably need to make it, even if it's a single book, two volumes to do any kind of serious justice. Structuring the book will prove interesting, you know, because of classic poetic forms and you know, or are you going to go chronologically?
After all that hard work, my question is, do you think, Joe, that it would sell? You know, how hard it is to sell poetry?
No.
Yeah.
Let me say I disagree. They sold out the Robert E. Howard complete poetry. The complete printing got sold. You've got to put it by the right publisher in the right format, and you sell it kind of by subscription. I actually believe there are enough collectors and people who would be interested. But the thing is, then you talk about the expense. You'd probably be limited to like a 300-issue run. some limited hardcover.
It would have to be a more expensive volume, you know, right. Which...
Well, and I the think thing you is, sell it out.
I want all these books in the hands of the readership. There are all kinds of Lovecraftians out there who may not be big poetry fans, but because of the nature of this kind of literature and because of Lovecraft's poetry, they would be interested. Mm-hmm. And a lot of this poetry isn't just good or wonderful. It's interesting to Lovecraftians. So if you price it where, and I hope nobody takes this wrong, but if you price it where your average Lovecraftian can afford to buy it, I don't know if you can a publisher can afford to do that.
Well, here's what Hippocampus did. Can I just...
Sure.
Did you ever get this? This is that one of the three volumes of the Complete Poetry and Translations of Clark Ashton Smith. They're gorgeous, gorgeous hardcover issue. They sold this out. And then what I think, I don't know for sure, I'm inferring, this gave them the impetus to then release it in soft cover.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that it would be something similar. It was done through Hippocampus. They could do like a couple volume series, sell out their limited hardcover. That would give them the funds to put out a more available edition in soft cover.
Right. And I don't mind that at all. I actually think that if you can release a book as a attractive, maybe a little bit more expensive hardcover, you know, with ribbons and slipcases for the collector, that's great. As long as you give regular readership the opportunity to, you know, pay for, like I said, a $20 trade paperback that they can afford. Because I don't... you ask Bill, you ask Pete, you ask me, you ask Rick. We want to be read. You know, we are not the kind of guys going, hey, look, I got a book, I'm somebody. Big deal. We're not musicians. We don't play for a crowd. We don't get applause at the end. You want that book out there where someone can read it, and maybe you see, you know, a positive review on Amazon, or maybe somebody says, oh, I just finished your book. It was really great, man. You know, I mean, that can get you high for the whole week. You know, your feet can leave the planet. You know, maybe not, well, maybe not leave the planet, but you can be... your contacts out of the blue and tells you how much they enjoyed this story or this collection. That's what we're working for. Yeah. This act of creativity that we do alone is an amazing, wonderful, maddening, horrible, beautiful thing. But when we're done, we want our children out in the world, and we would like them to succeed. You know.
The other way you could go here is actually do it like essentially as a chapbook. You could do like the quarterly journal of retrospective Lovecraftian poetry. Make it like a $5 piece. Do 100 pages, and you could run for years.
Yeah, it could run for years, but I'd really like to.
You'd like to see him big and impressive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, and I do, if I was just so I sometimes I'm charmed by that idea. And I think for this and I think that would be good for this type of presenting this kind of material. You know, well, the same way you're doing round robins. It would be illogical to put them any way other than chronological. You know?
Yeah. So on that, Joe, I will tell you this. We put, for Legacy of the Reanimator, we put the stories in chronological order. Mm-hmm. We actually played with the idea of breaking up the round robins, including the original story, and putting everything in chronological order.
Because the round robins cover like 20 years or 30 years.
Right.
Yeah.
Some stories fit in between other stories. So we actually played with that idea, and we decided against it.
Yeah, but, because these things already appeared, and they were...
Right.
They were a complete project, yeah.
Right.
You see how each writer influenced the other. You have to publish a round robin together.
Yes. Yeah. So we debated back and forth on that. We talked about that a lot because it would be an interesting way to present the book.
It would.
So.
That's the kind of thing where it would almost be interesting is if money were no object, you could do it and then you could have a second book where they were chronologically,
right.
Or at least the ones that needed to be.
Well, yeah. you could Kickstarter this thing, and you could raise a bunch of money if there was a lot of interest.
Well, I will tell you that somebody actually emailed me, and suggested that since all of the Lovecraft works I'm citing are in the public domain, republish the books with the original stories laced in.
Hmm.
So Reanimators would triple in size.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a very attractive idea. I don't want to have to commit to that project. If somebody wants to do it.
I would prefer, Pete, I'd actually prefer an annotated version with the author's notes.
Yep.
That would actually, I'd actually buy a slip-cased hardcover of that.
Yeah, I don't mind to mix Lovecrafting with your own.
Good. It's an interesting concept, but I don't know how you would do it.
Because you're gonna run into the same problem. If you start to do that, you're gonna be condemned like L. Sprague de Camp and Lynn Carter.
Yeah,
I can see that coming. You're mixing, you know, it's one thing that continue another author's work. You're making yourself equal to the original.
Except for
right on the pedestal.
Except for when you're working within this pond, you're already putting yourself up there for at least potentially getting your guts handed to you.
Yeah.
I mean, you're going to get compared to this, that, and that, whether you want to be or not, because this is... The people in this community have a tendency to love it, and it's theirs. So once you dip your toes in the water, you know, you're open.
Right. I will tell you that there have been two diametrically opposed views. I got one a couple months ago that said these books are a muddled mess. And then I got one from, she's a professor of Tolkien studies and fantastic fiction, and she just loved Reanimators.
I think I know who you're talking about.
And I was just thrilled with that.
Well, let's go.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, this is true of any crossover fiction, whether it be Philip Jose Farmer or whatever. Or your works, or even mine. You're tying it into another writer's work. You're not self-contained. It's not, you know, like Stephen King's Dark Tower is contained within his own works, and though, you know, his more current works, he's bringing in his crossovers with his son's works. And he had a little few crossovers to Peter Straub, but they were minor. It's like does not, you know, if you haven't read Lovecraft, can you could you appreciate Reanimators? That's the debate, or, you know, just like I did a sequel to Phantom of the Opera. If you hadn't read Phantom of the Opera, could you appreciate my book?
Right.
And I understand that, Pete, and we all get that. I mean, with all the King in Yellow material I've written, most people have been really nice and really complimentary, but I did at one point get a Facebook message from somebody who is a King in Yellow Chambers fanatic and only those four core stories and nothing else, and told me that I had no business going there. That material was holy grail, and it was an affront that I was trying to take it over, and blah, 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 blah.
Someone's taking life a little too seriously.
I just happen to be, well, we know I'm passionate about the King in Yellow, you know.
Yeah.
I didn't plan on writing this much King in Yellow stuff. It just keeps... It doesn't want to let me alone.
Look, when I was in high school and college, I wanted to be Larry Niven. Okay? It didn't work out that way.
Yeah.
Well, but it does one thing. It's one thing, you know, if you write a sequel to an established work, in a sense, you are trying to take it over. But it's one thing if you publish it separately saying, you know, this is my take on it. It's, you know, you can reject it, or, you know, it's isolated from the author's works. It's when you mix it in like Derlitz did and like DeCamp did.
There's not a single one of my King in Yellow pieces, and like I've said before, there's nearly 40 at this point, that I think anybody could call pastiche in any way, shape, or form.
And I'd agree with having read that. I mean, you use the mythology, but you don't...
But that's what this person was complaining about. It's like, how dare you take that over?
Can I just say something here? This is so stupid. Okay. J.S. Bach was famous for some keyboard concerti, and they later found out that these were works of Vivaldi that he had transcribed for harpsichord because he liked the music and he wanted to learn the techniques and play with the tools. And then he went on and wrote his own stuff with the similar Italian concerto style. This has been going on in all the arts for ages. This stuff is living and breathing. It moves people in other ways, you know. You still wouldn't say that, like, it's not like Bach was hiding where he took his sources, you know what I mean?
And it wasn't you've got to be honest with what your source is.
And the other thing is, it wasn't like this was his final word on the subject. He took,
you know, what Rick, what you said a minute ago, as I've said several times, I'm publishing Scott Thomas's Sea of Ash. Well, I told Scott that I was writing a sequel of sorts to the Sea of Ash, and, you know, did I have his blessing? I had no problem never publishing it in any venue whatsoever. I was basically, it grabbed me, like you said, Joe, and wouldn't let me go, so I'm writing it. Mm-hmm. Well, Scott's thrilled to death that I'm writing it and flattered and everything, which was a great reaction to get. And one of his questions was I including it in the Sea of Ash? And I thought that would be arrogant in the extreme for me to do that, you know.
You know, it wouldn't be that. Just including those two wouldn't be that bad. It's more like the thing that fandom points to is what happened with Conan.
Mm.
And we had this thing. Essentially, it wasn't Conan by Robert E. Howard. It was Conan by Robert E. Howard, Elspeth DeCamp, and Lynn Carter.
Mm.
The way that was packaged, and the stories became totally inseparable in the mind of the reader. Now, if they had, like, say, if DeCamp had said, I'm going to publish Howard alone, and then I'm going to have, you know, Lynn and I are going to do some continuations, and they'll be in separate volumes, there would have been less of an outcry than has resulted over the years.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to expand on something that Matt said earlier. You know, I am mining the stories, and I'm writing what happened before and after and off screen. And I'm very passionate about that because some things just don't make sense to me.
You know, and let me interject real quick, and then you continue. You have to write what you're passionate about. That's right. All there is to it.
Right. I mean,
right, or you do not convince the reader. That's our job, is to convince the reader that this is... I mean, we need to find some way to get inside a reader's head, somebody who's sitting somewhere that we are not, that we've never been. We don't know who this person is. We don't know what they think about this, and that. And our job is to get inside their head and mess with it. If you're not passionate when you're writing it, you got no hope of playing. I mean, it's a tango. You write, they read.
Yep.
They bring their own sensitivities to the work. And if you haven't done your job with as much passion as you can bring to it, you have no hope of being a true partner in this tango that's about to happen.
So what were you going to say, Pete?
So the statement of Frank Elwood, which is my retelling of Dreams in the Witch House from Frank Elwood's point of view, I just didn't want to write it because I wanted to tell from his point of view. I'm genuinely interested and bothered by the fact that Frank Elwood walks in and out of the story very conveniently. He's only there half the time. Where is he off? You know, his best friend is suffering dreadfully. Mm-hmm. Why is he vanishing? Where is he going? What else is going on? What's much more important?
And it's those little holes.
Right.
Whether my story is any good or not, it's in Children of Old Leech. It's like, okay, I got invited to this Laird Barron tribute. And the one thing, I mean, let's forget how incredible Laird is. Let's just set that aside. He is. He's a titan in his work. But in Broadsword, the guy is cleaning out this apartment. And he's putting all these books and things down on the curb. And then he goes in and we get the story of this guy. He spent days in the heat going from the sixth floor, coming down all those garbage, man. What was in them and where did they go? Because let's face it, in any city, if there's all of a sudden on the street corner a ton of boxes of books driving by, can you see Matt or Pete, even if they've got somewhere to go, they're on their way to work or something.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden it's like, oh my God, there's enough for like two vans, and it's all old books.
Oh, yeah.
Their cars are parked, ladies and gentlemen. Those guys are digging through them boxes. They are filling their car. They're like, well, I'm supposed to be at work, but the hell with that. They don't care.
So I'll tell you a true story. When I was dealing books, I went to an estate auction. And I went through the house, and there's little books scattered all over the place, paperbacks here and there. I finally found like three books that I wanted in the bedroom upstairs. So the auction starts, and we bid up the first room. And the auctioneer finishes up, and he looks around and says, anything else? I say, what about the books? He says, don't worry about it. We'll do those at the end. So we go through room after room after room for hours. And he keeps putting the books off. We'll do them later. So like 4 hours go by, and I'm like the last person there. He sells the bedroom set to some furniture dealer, and he looks at me and says, you want the books? And he says, yeah. He says, give me an opening bid. And I say, $5. And he says, all the books in the house are yours. But the way an estate auction works is that you have to take everything. That's the point.
So he was using you to haul the books away.
Oh my God, Danielle Steele burns beautifully. Jackie Collins, Danielle Steele. Oh, you know, I had an entire van full of crap and three books wrapped in plastic up front.
Those three books were really wild.
But the thing is with books, okay, is when I was a little kid, when I was 12, my mother used to have a friend who read basically romance paperbacks. And she would come over often with a paper bag full. I mean, she read them once and passed them along. One day she comes in, and on the sofa by the front door, she sets down a half of a banana box, you know, cardboard. It's filled with paperbacks. And they go out, and they're sitting in the dining room. They're having coffee. And there's this box of books. And sitting in right on the top is a book by Clark Howard called The Arm that has a half-naked stripper on the cover. Joey Pulver's 12 years old and doesn't see 12-year, you know, half-naked strippers. He's like, oh, my God. So he stands there staring for a few seconds, and he reaches down, and he picks his paper back up, and he goes upstairs, and he shoves it under his mattress, and it's his first hard-boiled crime that he's ever read. And he becomes a stark, raving lunatic for the next 50 years, basically. It was the only crime that I ever saw, and after that I would look through the bags and boxes. It was the only one I ever saw. But you just don't know what you're going to come across at any of these things. Pete, you know that. Matt, you must have been to book sales and stuff. You never know.
Here's my, it's kind of an inverse, it's my book box thing. You know, like, I was so happy to read Sheena Clayton's Tide of Desire, which was really written by Brian McNaughton.
Uh-huh. And
we had heard that he had written some other Miskatonic U-type hard-boiled stuff under the pseudonym Mark Bloodstone.
Mark Bloodstone, yep.
So I went ahead and I ordered a book. I don't know what I paid for it. It was a lot of money for a paperback, an ancient paperback called Bad Penny. And I get it, and it's just pornography.
Yeah, porn!
Every other page, and it's like, it was pitiful. There was nothing mythos, nothing horror. It was just, this is McNaughton trying to pay his rent that day, or a bottle of booze. And I was so, I didn't want anyone to know I had it. I didn't want to give it away or sell it because I didn't want to burn it because it was a book. So I actually, I put it in a shoebox and I put it out on the curb.
Oh, no.
No.
No. You know, it's funny because I can remember sitting in Bob Price's living room and McNaughton being there and talking. And, you know, McNaughton's talking about he's working in Neptune, New Jersey. He's the overnight desk clerk in this no-tell motel. You know, people check in for an hour. Sometimes they check in, and 10 minutes later they leave, kind of deal. So, and there's not a lot of customers, you know? So he's writing. And one of the things he was writing on a fairly regular basis was porn. Because you put a fake name on it, you mail it in, and whammo, there's a great check. You don't have editor problems. You don't have any problems. You write it, you mail it in, you open your mailbox, and there's a nice check. There's no bitching, there's no waiting, there's nothing. You know, and do you have the three Satan books? Satan's Mistress, Satan.
Yeah.
But only one of those has porn in it, the first one.
Right. I think they're charming as hell. I still remember the day he talked about them, and I got right up, I went on Bob Price's computer, I signed out of my Amazon account and found copies. Actually, it wasn't Amazon. I had to go through ABE back then.
They've all been rewritten, though, right?
Pardon me?
They were all rewritten without the...
Yes, that's Gemini Rising, Downward to Darkness, Worst Things Waiting, and The House Across the Way.
Yeah.
And the only one that was really majorly revised was the Downward to Darkness, He Excised the Pornography. Because that really didn't appear that much in the other books.
And I don't know that we've ever discussed this book, but for Lovecraftians, people who don't know Brian McNaughton's The Throne of Bones, it is
Ghoul anthology.
Anybody with an interest in ghouls, you absolutely need The Throne of Bones.
It's marvelous.
It's an incredible piece of work on every level.
It's not really a novel. It's more like a collection of linked stories.
Yeah, well, some of those stories were written completely separately, but then just compiled into a novel-length work.
It's wonderful. Actually, I think that these Lovecraftian
novels... I would call it a perfect book.
His Lovecraftian novels are excellent. I personally don't view The House Across the Way as Lovecraftian, but Downward to Darkness, Worst Things Waiting, they're brilliant. I actually think they're great. They're just brilliant.
I think he was one of the best writers we had. He just did a lot of stuff to pay bills, which there's nothing wrong with that, you know.
So, Dad?
Yeah?
There are no copies of Bad Penny available right now. You could have named your price.
I can't help it. It's just, I would have had to admit that I owned it.
The next time you want to get rid of any book, would you please send us an email first? Because, you know, things like taste. You might go, that's no good, but one of us fools might be dying to get our paws on it.
This was ages ago, Joe. It wasn't any time recent.
Yeah.
Carl Edward Wagner also wrote a porn novel.
Yeah.
Really?
Under the name Ken Allard.
Oh, I didn't know that.
I don't have a copy. I just know it exists.
Early in his career, Dean Koontz wrote a guide to the underground sex clubs.
Oh. Really?
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Okay, guys, I gotta get back to bed. I'm not doing too good today.
All right, we've killed this horse for 2 hours.
Yeah.
I gotta go eat, feed the kids.
I gotta do laundry.
Thanks for talking, guys.
Yeah, with all that underwear.
Thanks, everybody, for watching.
Yeah.
Good night, guys.
Good night.
Night, everybody.